The church was functional, it was acting, it was buzzing, it was spirit-filled. Amen? Let us thank the Lord for all the ministers of God that held. I was going to say held the fort, but no, it is not holding the fort. They are actually doing what God has called them to do. Amen? Because it is not just Pastor Kemi and I that God has called to stand before his people and minister words of wisdom to them. Amen? God has called all of you. Amen? So, whether we are here or not here, I want you to understand that the church of God stands. Amen? And in fact, I want to, it's been a burden in my heart for the, I call it the newer members of the church. Let me say newer. Although, sometimes the newer members are the younger ones. And those of us who are getting older, we have the liberty to call you younger people. Amen. Hallelujah. It doesn't mean you are young, it just means you are younger. But we want to begin to encourage younger people, not just young men, but 30-something, 40-something-year-olds, to do something, to hold on to a something within the church. This is my ministry. This is my work. This is what I'm doing. This is what I'm contributing to the church. Because when you do that, you'll be amazed at how much God will enlarge your coast. Sister Trish, evangelism is not just for you. You are the person that has received the burden at the moment. We also have received the burden for evangelism. But at the moment, God is pushing you forward, but it's not your responsibility alone. It is the whole church. Everything we do in church is about evangelism. We should not be an inward facing church where we all come, have worship, praise, and go home. Then we will remain just who we are. But we need to face outwards. What we do here has to be of such joy, expression, that it brings people in. It draws them in. They want to be part of us. We want to be part of them. So we need to go out and share with them, but we also need to facilitate them to come here. And the bus is one of those things. Amen. Can we give the Lord a round of applause for the new bus? Amen. And I need to say this in front of the whole church. If you can just spare 1 minute, because I need to say this in front of the whole church. It is important, and for many years, Christ Divine has not been able to have an effective bus service. But every time I come to church, I never fail to see 3 or 4 buses of other churches just going through. I'm sure you all see them. They go past your house, they go past your neighbors, they are always circling around. It's almost as if you are not taking your pick of what God has given you. And we have, by the grace of God, corrected that. But I'm standing before the church today to declare that the bus will not run itself. It needs people to support it. But let me describe the bus this way, as a part of our evangelism exercise. Because you see, the purpose of the bus is not to make things convenient for people to come to church. It's to make them to come to Christ in a way that doesn't burden them. And it's also to give that visual signal to their neighbors and their friends that this place that you are going, that you come back with so much joy in your heart, I want to go with you. Amen. We all agree with that, isn't it? So it's one of those things that we do. And honestly speaking, a church like Divine should have had 2 or 3 buses out there. But we're going to get there. One of you, I prophesy that God will bless you, that you will bring a bus and say, Pastor, I have bought a bus for the church. These things are not unaffordable. They're not way expensive. Within the resources, but God will establish you and God will settle you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. But what we have now, we need to run it effectively. But I know that some of us live close to church. We can walk to church, great. Some of us have our own transport. We can come to church in our own transport. That's fantastic. But that does not mean that we should not be part of the process of evangelizing and bringing people into the church. And for that reason, it is important that every member of Christ Divine contributes something towards the transportation service. But I want to call it towards evangelism. So we will be taking an evangelism offering every Sunday. I told you when I came back from Nigeria, I went to this church where it did that every Sunday. I don't know what they do with it, but that church is full. That church has lots of things going on. So it gives us the opportunity to do lots of stuff. So whether you want to partner by making sure that every Sunday you bring something, or once a month you put it as a direct debit, that's whatever you do it, just something. You'll be amazed at how little you need to put in a regular way to contribute a long way. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I'm standing here and I'm encouraging everyone who's hearing me today that please put something aside every month. If it's £5 a week, these little children, even the treats you give them, for each one is more than £5 a week. The treat you give them is more than that. The treat you give yourself is more than £5 a week. But if you can't afford £5 a week, £5 a month, that's fine. Whatever it is that the Lord puts in your heart, you can put it in the basket when it comes through. Or we can have a standing thing that says evangelism. So you put something in every time. Or you can put it in as a direct debit, with send instructions out, just say evangelism fund. £5, £10, whatever, and forget about it. And you'll be amazed at what God will do in your life. That's not your tithes and offering, it's not that. It's an extra thing. You know that I'm doing something. We're going to have a discussion with those who are coming on the bus to talk about other logistics, but I'm just encouraging every single member of the church that Christ Divine has not moved fast enough over the years, and we need to correct it. And the way to correct it is in our tithes, to be faithful with our tithes, and to bring an offering to the church, and to contribute to special needs. And evangelism, Jesus Christ says, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. Teaching them, make disciples. Sometimes you need to go and bring them. You need to go and facilitate them. You need to take a home group to them. We may need to establish a home group somewhere. We need to do all those things. So by the grace of God, we will give you more information about, can we have a round of applause to that? And that means you are agreeing with me that you will support this initiative. So please think about that. It's doable. God bless you. It is time for our word. Are we already on tape? That's fine. It's all part of church. This morning, I'm going to speak just maybe for 20 minutes and give Brother Wally just some time to talk about the logistics of the transport. You're not prepared? Okay, all I want you to do is to say, this is what I've done for the past 2 weeks. I pick them from here, from here, from there, and then whoever else wants to pick, let them put their names down, and then we'll work out a more detailed route. You did that last week. Okay. But there are some people here today who were not picked up last week who may want to join in. So what we'll do is, at the end of the service, we will simply ask people to put their names down, and then we'll work out something else, and we'll give them a ring, tell them how they will be picked up next week, if they want to be picked up next week. Shall we pray? Shall we pray? Father, we bless you. We give you praise. We lift up your name. We declare that you are King of Kings. We declare that you are Lord of Lords. We declare that you are the Alpha and the Omega. You are the one that we serve. You are the one that we worship. You are the one that directs our affairs. Lord, we commit today into your hands. Lord, I pray that you will speak your word to us this morning. Let it be a word in season. Let it be a word that will build us up for your kingdom. Lord, we bless you. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
A bigger amen.
Amen.
A louder amen.
Amen.
A greater amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Shall we open our Bibles to Mark 3, verse 31. Mark 3, verse 31. I'm going to just read a little Bible passage about Jesus Christ and his disciples and his family. The title of the message this morning is, Who is My Family? Amen. I'm happy that you are all here with your children. Amen. Who is my family? All of us are part of connected families. The title of the message is, Who is my family? Word of God says, Then his brother and his mother came, and standing outside, And standing outside, they sent to him, calling him. And a multitude was sitting around him, that's around Jesus Christ. And they said to him, Look, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. But he answered them, saying, Who is my mother or my brothers? And he looked around in his circle at those who sat around him and said, Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God is my brother and my sister and my mother. Let me read the version in Matthew 12:46. Matthew 12:46. It describes it slightly different, but it's the same sort of thing. And you see, Jesus Christ comes at things in a very, very different way. And we ought to see things differently once he has shown us the way to see things. And the word of God says, while he was still speaking to the multitudes, it starts with the multitudes, behold, his mother and brother stood outside seeking to speak with him. Then one said to him, Look, your mother and your brothers are standing outside seeking to speak to you. But he answered and said to the one who told him, Who is my mother and who are my brothers? And he stretched out his hand towards his disciples and said, Here are my mother and my brothers, for whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and my sister and my mother. That is awesome. For Jesus Christ to almost appear to be denying his mother and his brothers and saying, "Who?" It's almost like he's saying, I don't know them. But he's not saying that. He's not saying that. What he's saying to his disciples and the multitude around them is that I have come with a different definition of who my mother and my brothers, and let me add sister, because his sister, we know he had sisters. We're not there. So add that, but not father. We only have one father in heaven. Amen. So Jesus Christ has redefined who a mother, brother, or sister are. He's saying to them that yes, it's not that that is not my biological mother, and this one's my biological siblings, but my definition according to God is that my mother and brothers and sisters are those who do the will of my Father in heaven. Amen. Anyone who does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and my sister. That is radical. And I really want all of us to begin to think that way. I want all of us to adopt that definition immediately. It is no longer a definition based on a genetic relationship, but on a spiritual relationship. That means Jesus Christ has given us a spiritual common denominator of who our mother and brothers and sisters are. Do you know that it is so radical that it is liberating to know that no longer are you limited by genetic ties? Even if you are born as a single child, you have brothers and sisters. You know that. That's what he's telling you. Even if you were born into a large family and all of them, you don't know where they are anymore, you have fallen out with them, and I pray you don't fall out with your family, you still have a mother, you still have sisters and brothers. Even if for some reason they have departed and gone to be with the Lord, put it that way, you are still not left alone. I want you to really think about that. That means that there is no one in Christ who does not have a mother. No one. There's no one in Christ that is who does the will of the Father in heaven who does not have a brother. There's no one in Christ who does not have a sister. In fact, the world is full of potential sisters and brothers and mothers for you. Amen. That means you can leave this country and go to Japan or go to Malaysia. As hard as it might be, you will find one or two brothers. Those who are doing the will of the Father in heaven. And you can feel free to identify with them because the common denominator is that of God. Amen. And you can never be wrong. Do you know that you can make sure that your business partners are your brothers and sisters? Not the whole. Listen, let me tell you something. To go into business with your genetic brothers and sisters is the most dangerous thing anybody can do. Unless it was a business your father started, you don't have a choice. But people still fall out. But to start one with your biological siblings is very, very difficult. And to also start a business with people whom you do not have a spiritual connection or relationship with is just as bad. That's why the word of God says, do not be unyoked. Do not be yoked with unbelievers. But to start a relationship, a business relationship with people who are doing the will of God is not people who you belong to the same church with. Don't misunderstand me. Because sometimes you are too close to each other, you mess up. But you know this guy, without him telling me, I know he's doing the will of God. I can see his business ethics. I can see his business practices. I can identify with him. I can see his family structure and dynamics. Even without him saying anything, I think my spirit connects with him. The Holy Spirit will connect you with such people. And you can become a business partner with that brother or that sister. Amen. Amen. Do you know, not only that, it breaks you free from gender restrictions. Perchance, do you know that you can be my sister? I know we are good men. But I can have a relationship with you as a brother to a sister. Because if I need a sister's relationship and you're the only one, I'm not going to look for somebody else. I will tap into that feminine. Maybe what I need from you is advice. What does a sister do? Or support? You see what I mean? I can relate to you as a sister. I can relate to anybody here as my mother. Even you know you may be a man. Or you can be a woman. Even younger than myself. I hope you understand what I'm saying. So I have all of you are my mothers. I can feel free to unburden stuff to you as a son to a mother. Regardless of my age, regardless of your age, and so can you. That is liberating. That's why he said, all of these people are my mother. He didn't say, the older women in the discipleship are my mother. I hope you understand that. He said, whoever does the will of my father
is my mother. So I want to encourage you to see that you have many mothers available. When you need that thing that a mother needs to impart, you can seek it out. You can come to me as your pastor, as your mother. I used to believe that my relationship with women in the church has to be through Pastor Kenny. And I've done that for many years. And we pastors, we get taught that we should do that because to maintain certain things. But sometimes it doesn't allow you to be close to the people who want to be close to you. Because there is, it's like a proxy relationship. So within limits, you can see me as your mother. And you can certainly see me as your brother. And I can see you as my brother or sister. Amen. Don't you feel liberated? So what we're saying is this. That the word of God says, the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness. The world, let's go to Psalm 24 verse 1. The earth and is the Lord's and all its fullness. The world and those who dwell in it. Hallelujah. The earth is the fullness. That means the fullness of the Lord is yours. He says the world and those who dwell. So if you are doing the will of the Father, have the confidence that I can ask for help from anyone, obviously a child of God. I will have the confidence to demand it in the name of Jesus, that you should do this service to me, and you will do it and be constrained by God to do it. Amen.
Amen.
So seek out help when you need help, and don't just wait on because you don't until you can you know the face of the person. Amen. What I'm saying to you is this, that if the world is full of your brothers and sisters, and this church certainly is full of your brothers and sisters, then don't wait. Begin to have connections. Begin to have connections with your brothers and sisters and mothers, and let these connections be fruitful. Let us see the effect of those connections. So far, it's difficult to see. When I see this sister, I'm not so sure whether that brother, I can see them doing things together. There are some people we have put in departments. We know they are working in departments. But there's a ministry that God has given all of you. Isn't it? So you can begin to work together. Just identify, ask the Lord to show you that, Lord, I want to do this thing, but I need a brother or sister to help, or even a mother. And God will show you somebody. And you begin to work together. Amen.
Amen.
Even if the pastor doesn't put you there, we begin to see that these two people, wow, it is not for them. They are so dynamic. They do this thing. They say, Pastor, don't worry. We'll deal with this. Let us see it. Because you already have brothers. You have sisters. And it's not the kind of brothers where you have jealousy or envy. It is the kind of brother where there is Christian fellowship amongst you. Amen.
Amen.
Just for a few minutes, let me talk about doing the will of the Father in heaven. Because that is what defines the common denominator of who your brother or sister is. Let's see what Jesus Christ had to say about doing the will of the Father in heaven. Let's go to John 4. John 4. And I will quickly read from 28 to 36, very, very quickly. John 4, 28. This is the woman at the well. You know the story. The Samaritan woman at the well that Jesus Christ met and who he prophesied into her life. She had 5 husbands. She wasn't married to any of them, but she was a special woman. She was the first person he said, I am the Christ. He told her, I am the Christ. And he told her that the true worshippers will worship the Lord in spirit and truth to a Samaritan woman. And this woman, when all this revelation came, what of God says, 28, this woman left her water pot and went into the city and said to the men, come see a man who told me all the things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? Then she went out. Then they went out of the city and came to him. In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, "Rabbi, eat." But he said to them, "I have food to eat of which you do not know." Therefore his disciples said to one another, "Has anyone brought him anything to eat?" Jesus said to them, "My food," listen carefully please, "my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." That's the food of Jesus. He said, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." So what I'm saying to you is that when you are doing the will of God in heaven, you are actually feeding. And that food will nourish you. That food will bring you to maturity. Amen. Amen. That food will bless you. Amen. You are not giving, you are receiving. Honestly. And I want you to hold on to that. That when you are working for the Father, when you are doing His will, when you are doing something that you know God has asked me to do, you are actually feeding. You are actually feeding on Him. And this food is freely supplied by Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. That food is freely supplied by Jesus Christ. I want you to understand that there is a blessing. Amen. Amen. There is a blessing in doing the will of God and feeding on it. Let me read further. Then Jesus Christ said to them in 35, "Do you not say, there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for harvest." So what he's saying to them is this, that don't wait. Amen? Please, can we just pay a bit of attention, please? He's saying to them, don't go by the normal events. Because in the normal course of events, you say, "Oh, 4 months to harvest." But he said, "Open your eyes and look around you. There's stuff to be done already." Are you getting me? He says, "There's stuff to be done already. Now. They are already white for this harvest." But look at the next verse. And this is a very important point, which I don't know many of you really appreciate. Verse 36. He says that the harvest is ripe the fields are ripe for harvest in verse 35. Verse 36, he now explains something to you. He says, "He who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this the saying is true, one sow, another reap. I sent you to reap for that which you have not labored, others have labored and you have entered into their labors." What is saying to you is this, that the field is already ripe for harvesting. But do you know that what God is asking you to do is just go and harvest? But it's reminding you that you are the one that will collect the wages for the one who sowed and didn't reap. The one who died evangelizing the whole of Mustang and gave leaflets to people that didn't come to church. You just put money into the church fund. You put money in the evangelism fund. And somehow that person was reached and became a Christian. And God will account that to you and to that person. That's why the word of God says, I sent you to reap that you have not labored. It is important because there are people who have labored and labored. They have sown seed and is now ripe for harvest, but they are no longer here. Maybe they moved on somewhere else. Maybe there's a work in the church that you are supposed to do. And some people have done it and done it and done it. It's not really worked out, and suddenly you just come and you add a bit of spice to it. And suddenly, it begins to jump. People begin to wow. Like, you go to a church where the praise and worship team is struggling. They've been struggling maybe for 2 or 3 years. And suddenly, you add a bit of value to it. And suddenly, whoa, things begin to happen. You are receiving the reward for your reaping and everybody else who has put in an effort into it. Can we give the Lord a big round of applause to that? So there's a lot to be said that feed on the will of God. Feed on the will of God. I say feed on the will of God. And God has made it easy for us. Because the word of God in Ephesians 2 verse 10, and I'm closing now, it says that we are his workmanship, created for good works, which Christ has already done before for us to walk in them. Ephesians 2 verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, for good works, which he has prepared beforehand. All you need to do is walk in them. All you need to do is reap. All you need to do is add a bit of catalyst to it. All you need to do is put your own effort in. Amen. Amen. And suddenly, you find that the effort of everybody else that has been put in before begins to work. Don't let it get to your head. If you are building on effort. You look at the world today. Look at a mobile phone. How did it start? There is no one who could have gone to his bedroom, who lived in the Stone Age, and would develop this. This technology came through millions of little discoveries. Somebody discovered electricity, somebody discovered something, somebody discovered plastic, somebody discovered how to put things together over many, many years. So many people have sown, but over time, you add value. You add value, you add value, you add value. I pray you be a value added person in the name of Jesus. You be a value adder in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So finally, I want to go back to this family. What I'm saying to you is this, and I'm finished with this. Mark 10, verse 29. Just to reassure you that when you begin to think that my family, my real family, trust me on this, my real family is not my biological mother or biological father or brothers and sisters or even my children. My real family is the family of God. Do you know that Mary, the mother of Jesus, had to become his disciple? She followed him everywhere. She became part of the disciples. Everywhere the disciples were, she was there with them. Even his brother, James, and etc., they became his disciples. That was the only way he can relate to them. So he did not give them an advantage. Amen? He did not give them an advantage. Because there is no greater advantage you can give somebody who already has God's advantage. Amen. Amen. Can I say that again? When God has already lifted you up, you cannot lift anybody beyond that level. So he needed to lift his family into the level of the family of God. And that was how it happened. So Jesus Christ said, "Assuredly, I said to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's who shall not receive 100-fold now in this time." Can I have an amen to that?
Yes.
100-fold of houses, 100-fold of brothers, 100-fold of sisters, 100-fold of mothers, 100-fold of children, 100-fold of lands. Amen.
Amen.
You know, he didn't say 100-fold of fathers. Because he is one. God is one father. But he said, those who have left house, brothers, sisters, or fathers, or mothers, or wife, or children, or land for my sake and the gospel's, they will receive a hundredfold now in this time while you are alive. Hundredfold of houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children, even with persecution. And in the age to come, you receive eternal life, which cannot be quantified in multiples. You, in the eternal life and this life you live, is not hundredfold or thousandfold. Eternity and eternity is, you can't compare. You can't compare. It's eternal. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So let us have a purpose. Our focus has to be Jesus Christ. The Word of God says He is the chief cornerstone. And Apostle Paul said, not that I've already attained or I'm perfected. That is Philippians 3 verse 12. He says, not that I am have attained or perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold on that for which Christ has laid hold on me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting this behind, I reach forward to those things that are ahead. I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. So let us continue to look upon Jesus Christ, the author and finisher of our faith. Can we stand up, church? Let us stand. Let us stand. Let us stand. Let us stand. Jesus Christ said, my food is to do the will of the Father and to finish it. Don't let's forget that. And to finish it. You are meant to be finishers. You are meant to finish the work that others have started so that others will get that reward. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray that, Father, give us the zeal to do the will of the Father. Let us begin to pray. Father God, give us the zeal to do the will of the Father in heaven. Give us the zeal. Let us have the zeal, no matter what it is, that even before we know what we are asked to do, let us feel that, Father, we want to do this. I want to do the will of the Father. Give me the zeal. Give me the zeal to do the will of the Father in heaven. Father God, give me the zeal. Father God, give me the zeal. Father God, give me the zeal to do the will. The Word of God says that Jesus Christ went into the temple and he scattered all those who were doing the wrong things, who were not doing the will of the Father. Those who were paying, those who were the money lenders, who were selling pigeons, selling all sorts of stuff. He kicked them out because he said, they have turned my Father's house into a den of thieves. The zeal of the house of God held him, overtook him. Let's have that zeal. The second prayer point is, Father, open my eyes and my ears to know what your will for me is. Let's begin to pray. Father God, open my eyes and ears to know what your will for me is. There's a general will for us to do the will of the Father. But each one of us, there is a specific calling. So Father, show me what it is that I am meant to do for you. Oh Lord, and when you show it to me, I will not rest until I have done it. I will not rest until I have completed it, oh God. Ask the Lord to show you. 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 In Jesus' name we pray. Recognizing that we are in a family. We have mothers, brothers, and sisters. Say, Father, surround me with mothers, brothers, and sisters to do this work. Oh, connect me with the right brother, the right sister, the right mother to do this work, oh God. Lord, connect me. Make me a mother. Make me a brother. Make me a sister to somebody. Let there be a mother to me. Let there be a sister to me to do this work. To do this work. It may be simple. It may be so simple. It may be complicated according to your will for me. But Father, connect me to the right people.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we lift your name up. We thank you for this opportunity to discover who our real family is. Father, we are not denying that we have a biological family, but we're recognizing that you have given us an everlasting family, a family of God that is everywhere, an omnipotent family, an omniscient family, a family that spreads all over the world, a family that has the fullness of the world at its disposal, a family that does not limit us, a family that enlightens us, a family that lifts us up. Thank you, Lord, that we are surrounded. We are not alone. No matter what our problem with our biological family is, we have a greater family that is led by Jesus Christ. So, Lord Jesus, we thank you. We give you praise. We lift the name of God. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
Let us share the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely his goodness and his mercy shall follow us all the days of our life, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Just a very brief meeting, very, very quickly, with Brother Charles and Brother Wally. Just for a few minutes, and then everybody else who wants to go on the bus, please. Can somebody else take their names down? Do you have to take somebody out now?
We have their names already.
How about the ones who were not in church last week? Except Marie, okay. Sister Maria. Okay, so you contact them. Okay, so quick meeting with Brother Charles and Brother Wally. Okay, God bless you. And then after that, Pastor Kemi and I would like to have a very quick meeting with Deacon Kola before we leave the church. God bless you all. Have a wonderful day. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a big round of applause. Say to your neighbor, there shall be love, joy, and peace in your life. Say to your neighbor, can we please switch off? Can we switch off the live transmission, please? There shall be love, joy, and peace. Say to your neighbor, they shall be loved. You have to edit the last bit out, please.